Last time recapitalization was done by giving money to individual banks through the bond issue. The slight difference is that at that point of time, the banks had 100% government ownership. Now what happens is, when you are injecting equity, and I am the sole owner, then whatever I inject, it is my terms and conditions. Whereas I am one of the parties, there are private shareholding, government shareholding. Government is putting in equity, private sector also should be on par. Otherwise there will be windfall gains or windfall loss to the private shareholders. So therefore, for instance, when you see the private sector, the shares of private shares of bank going up, it means they are expecting the government to take more burden. But if it's like any other owner, how can it be? So the main difference now is how they are going to ensure, the government has to ensure that the terms and conditions of recapitalization equity, inject, there are two legs, equity, bond. So on both there's a qualitative difference. In regard to bonds, in those days the bonds were structured in a very crude manner because there was not a developed bond market. So they were put with the banks and they were not even traded. So there was no monetary implication in that sense. Whereas now the bond market is developed. And actually, if you recall later, we converted those bonds to marketable securities. I have written in my memoirs also how we did that. So now we are starting with the bond market. So therefore, the design of the bond, the terms and conditions of the bond, the tradability of the bond, the time period over which there is a lock-in period, and the interest, so that becomes a more complex issue because it should be market compatible. It's more challenging. So there are two legs. This is one leg. The other leg is the equity. So the equity, when you are providing equity, you are providing along with the private people. So technically you should give an option, like rights issue. And if they don't pick up, then somebody else may have to pick up. So the whole issue therefore is that you are going through a process in a different, more market-oriented environment. It is perfectly appropriate what the solution that is being done. And in fact, it could have been done before also, but whatever the reason, it has been done now. And in terms of fiscal monetary implications, this is acceptable by basically what is it happening? If you look at it fundamentally, what the government is saying is that I will assume the risk. The difference between the debt and equity is the equity holder is assuming the risk. So what the government says is that I will acquire that liability and create an equity asset. So the only thing that implicitly it is happening is that if this is able to get a return above the cost of borrowing, then there is not even a fiscal burden. The dividend plus appreciation value. That's not unreasonable. It's a welcome thing. It's necessary for the country. But how much benefit you will get will depend on two things. How we are structuring the injection of equity and bond terms, number one. Number two, the future functioning of the public sector banks. How we are going to have a proper vision and have. The one leg is fine, the second leg is yet to be defined. You see, private sector banks, very simple. When the asset classification has not been done properly, you do it. Once you do it, if there is inadequate capital, you ask them to bring the capital immediately. Otherwise, ask them to narrow banking. It's not a systemic issue, it's an individual bank issue. And whatever evidence we have there for so far, is that private sector banks have adequate capital. And if there's redefinition, either they have to reduce the operations or bringing the capital.